So to begin with, what is stylized 3D and non-photorealistic graphics? Sometimes you can hear artists describing it like 3D graphics not looking like generic 3D graphics. While obviously there is nothing wrong with the generic 3D look, we all intuitively know that type of look. When starting our journey of computer graphics, most of us 3D artists stay in this box for a while before moving on. So from this perspective, stylized means looking like something else, or in other words, it means, well, adoption of a style. The style as a set of properties can be defined very broadly. Say, it can look like a 2D painting, or like a drawing, like an illustration, like a comics, or a pixel art. Or it can be defined slightly more strictly, like a diorama, or a PlayStation 2 style game, or a recent Pixar movie, for example. Probably the first thing that comes to mind when we talk about stylizing 3D art is traditional 2D media. And indeed, so many techniques and approaches in this field of computer graphics have been inspired by two-dimensional sensibilities. The hand-drawn or painted look has proven to be super effective in breathing in some life into generic 3D art. Somehow, painterly connotations help to position your 3D art sufficiently far away from that uninspiring 3D look that we get by default when we start. The manually placed, randomized brush strokes, cross-hatching effects, and other properties of two-dimensional style like 2D sketching carry on into 3D domain of Blender or any other software without a hitch and bless it with the artistic qualities. Like we have pointed out already, the style can be defined very loosely, or it can be quite specific. It can be as specific as, for example, basing your rendering vibe on the comic book look based on the printing intricacies of the time. It was inspired by a specific technology existing in the specific historical time, having a specific set of limitations and features. And when we adopt such style, we mimic some of its most important features, for example, the halftone printing pattern that was used to save some ink, or the ink offset that looked a little bit like chromatic aberration. Interestingly, some of the styles that we may want to choose while working in the NPR environment are the styles that were inspired by specific technology or specific limitation of this technology. Think about PlayStation 1's style low poly models, or pixel art that was brought into existence thanks to some limitations of the technology, but then developed into a fully fledged aesthetics. And some other styles are not so reliant or inspired by a certain technology or medium, like the Studio Ghibli style, which is a constellation of various awesome things and traits which are unique to this studio. And then there are more, there are always more when we talk about non-photorealistic or stylized. There are a multitude of potential styles that you can choose from. Low poly, anime, hand-drawn, voxel art, hand-painted textures, and the list goes on and on and on and on. When we say not generic 3D, we can mean so many different things, actually. To put it very roughly, while generic 3D is one kind of thing, there are a multitude of things on the other side of the divide. The other way to define stylized computer graphics would be to use the term NPR, non-photorealistic rendering, which is once again a pretty vague description, but intuitively we all know what this means. All of us have a strong intuitive understanding of what photorealistic means and how it looks, so once we see it, we know it. We know that this is a photo of a car or a highly realistic render, but not stylized, clearly not. That being said, sometimes the perception of realism may get a little bit shaky, even though the rendering quality could be very realistic in fact. That could happen when some other element, like the design of the USPS car in this example, will move it to the NPR side. So it's not entirely about rendering, it's about many things like geometry, lighting, perspective, and so on. We will talk about that later. So all things considered, geometry, lighting, shading, animation, whatever else, it can be closer to or further away from what we vaguely call photorealism. Look at these six characters from Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. Each of them comes from the NPR domain, obviously, but each of them at the same time represent different distance from photorealism. And once again, these three characters from Pixar Soul are also NPR, but to a different extent, we may say. Mano, what do you think about this gradient of realistic and non-photorealistic things?
I remembered this one talk given by Blender Animation Studio member Hjalti Hjalmarsson. So you find this chart in the talk. There are basically the photorealistic stylized axis. It goes from fully realistic on the left to super simplified on the right. So for example, a photograph would be in the left corner, a child drawing of a face in the right corner, and various mixtures of those styles in between. The vertical axis is realistic versus abstract or non-representational. It starts photorealistic and then gradually becomes more and more abstract to the point of collapsing into a set of artist Kazimir Malevich type of shapes, which no longer look like a face at all. So all possible stylization options can be mapped onto this gamut by Hjalti. It's important to break the image down into elements. For example, rendering style in this image of the USPS car is highly realistic, but the design style leans towards the toon side of the Hjalti's triangle. Unsurprisingly, it shifts the perception of this image towards stylized. Separating these things too much could lead to interesting results. Cartoonish proportions plus ultra-realistic rendering and bam, uncanny valley, where you no longer know if it's still NPR or not. Amazing experiment by Miguel Vasquez.
Sometimes when we say stylized 3D, we mean simplified, decorative and exaggerated. And sometimes, in addition to that, abstracted and non-figurative. Practically the most of the techniques related to creating stylized 3D art boil down to these two things, simplification and exaggeration indeed. It's also a kind of a gradient. Using the toolset of reductionist, we decide what aspects of the image should be trashed and what should be left intact. Like, do we really need 3D perspective? Do we really need lighting? So on and so forth. And alongside reducing the unnecessary complexity, we also exaggerate stuff. That's the hallmark of stylized 3D art. We use raw oil of reality and we exaggerate a few things here and there and artistically transform it into something cool. Or think about it in this way. If the gray horizontal line here is some basic photoreal state, then this wobbly line represents exaggeration and simplification. Or in other words, amplifying some aspects of reality and dropping some other things, decimating them. These two operations seem to be the most fundamental in creating stylized 3D graphics. Alright, so far we covered these definitions. Not looking like a generic 3D, non-photorealistic as opposed to photorealistic, simplified and exaggerated. It all makes sense, but there is the fourth one, which is even more instrumental. Stylized 3D could mean following artist's intention. This one is a really fundamental principle that takes the artist's intention into account. We take control from software to define the fundamental rules for geometry, perspective, lighting, rendering and movement according to our artistic intent. Our artistic intent may involve breaking the rules in some crazy way, like what if this girl is casting a demon shadow? In the realm of all possible creative decisions, that one is totally viable. What we actually do when we create the NPR art is that we design the rules for color, for lighting and shadows qualia, for geometry, for perspective, for anything else, for rendering and for movement, for practically every aspect of the computer graphics pipeline. We take the control over these things and define precisely how they should function. You may want to imbibe some of these elements with abstract qualities or representational qualities on the other hand. You can make them realistic or not, cohesive or eclectic in terms of the style used. It's totally up to you. Incidentally, we have structured our new course on creating stylized 3D graphics in Blender around this theme, breaking down the NPR art creation pipeline into important elements and then learning how to twist and bend each one of them according to your artistic goals. So if you're interested, we would appreciate your support, feel free to get the course. So let me tell you a bit more about this course, show some cool examples, and let's see how you as an artist can split the rendering pipeline into important elements to set your own rules for each one of them. A major aspect of computer graphics to be aware of as an NPR artist is color. It starts with choosing and controlling the color palette, but then extends onto directly painting with color and not relying on the shading information generated by the render engine. Color is a very broad and omnipresent consideration in NPR art, and it blends in with the lighting and shading qualia. Without light, there is no vision, and to fully realize our creative vision, we should exactly define how the highlights look, how the gradation between different shades look, what are the shadows, what is the ambient aspect of lighting, and most importantly, to what extent are you ready to simplify and exaggerate the properties of light. Getting back to the color theme, it's absolutely fine to drop the lighting altogether and just play with the solid colors, that's your choice. For example, you may want to go shadeless and just paint everything directly into textures. The lighting, I mean, and just don't use the light sources at all in Blender. On the other hand, you may very well want to keep it hybrid and use the hand-painted textures with the lighting baked in, but use the light sources of Blender on top of it. It may end up looking awesome, you know? Then we have 3D modeling and everything else that directly connects to designing the geometry to worry about. The questions that we may ask to ourselves is what is the shape language or the visual flow that we have chosen for our geometry? What qualities do our 3D forms possess? Are they angular or more rounded or spaghetti-like or anything else? Like maybe the building blocks of our 3D shapes are really blocks, like in Minecraft. Voxels, in other words. Or does our style of geometry implies the low poly look? Aside from color, lighting and geometry, we can also control perspective. We can go isometric or orthographic, or on the other hand, we can try experimenting with the fisheye look that makes everything bulgy and curvy. And cute, I think. The perspective experiments can be much more brave than that. Think about artistically twisted perspective, like we see in The Day of the Tentacle. This is a stylistic choice of Euclidean versus non-Euclidean space when we think about it. So we are free to bend the rules of space. And then obviously rendering and post-processing is where the big part of the non-photorealistic magic happens. It's impressive how much you can do with modifiers and nodes in Blender Shader Editor and Compositor. It's crazy how much we can affect rendering to make our 3D stuff look very cool indeed. Think line art, pixelization, posterization, halftone effects, whatever else we can imagine. And lastly, we can control the low-level properties of movement for animation. For example, that could be a stylized motion blur in the Spiderverse, which involves smearing and doubling. Or it can be a crazy denoising effect in Blender, which resembles the Lord of the Rings style vision. Or for example, the painterly style transfer effect in EBSynth. Animation won't be the focus of the course though, but anyway, that's also something that can follow our artistic intention. So that is what we usually mean when we say stylized 3D. Not looking like a generic 3D, non-photorealistic or NPR, simplified and exaggerated, and lastly, following the artist's intention. I think that's a decent starting point for exploring what does stylized 3D means for you. Thanks so much for watching, my name is Gleb Alexandrov. If you want to learn more about creating stylized 3D art in Blender, feel free to get the full course on creativeshrimp.com. See you there.